In this lecture, I will explain what is meant by grand canonical ensemble. So far in this lecture series, I explained about microcanonical ensemble approach as well as canonical ensemble approach for deriving the thermodynamics of a system. In the microcanonical ensemble approach, what we did is we calculated the number of microstates accessible to a system by counting the number of possible solutions of Schrodinger equation or by counting the number of representative points of the phase space. And usually it is a difficult task to calculate this number of microstates. So we look for alternatives and we find that the canonical ensemble approach, where we calculated the partition function and thereby derived the entire thermodynamics of the system, is a lot more easier compared to the microcanonical ensemble approach. So it is quite natural to think of a new modification to canonical ensemble approach, and that is the motivation behind the study of grand canonical ensemble approach. So in microcanonical ensemble approach, idea is a fixed energy. That is, the system is isolated from the surroundings and it will have a fixed number of particle N, fixed volume V and fixed energy E. Using this concept, we derived the entire thermodynamics of the system. Now, assume that the system can exchange energy with the surroundings. That modification leads to canonical ensemble. There, temperature is fixed instead of energy. And the macrostate is defined by fixed number of particles, fixed volume, and fixed temperature. So, it is natural to look for new modification by changing both energy and particles. That is, the system can exchange both energy as well as particles with the surroundings. Then, that leads to grand canonical ensemble. There, instead of energy and number of particles, the fixed parameters are temperature and chemical potential. And the macrostate is defined by chemical potential mu, volume V, and temperature T. Now, as we did in the case of canonical ensemble, for grand canonical ensemble also, for the study of statistics of the number of particles N and energy E, we can either consider the system A to be immersed in a large reservoir A prime with which it can exchange both energy and particles. For canonical ensemble, we consider the system A to be immersed in a reservoir with which it can exchange only energy. That was an energy reservoir. But for a grand canonical ensemble, the reservoir can exchange both energy and particles. Or we can regard the system as a member of a large collection of identical systems known as grand canonical ensemble, the members of the ensemble carrying out a mutual exchange of both energy and particles. In the case of canonical ensemble, the members of the ensemble carrying out a mutual exchange of energy only. Here, they can exchange both energy and particles. Both these approaches will give you the same end results. Now, we will consider approach 1, that is equilibrium between a system and a particle energy reservoir. For canonical ensemble, this was equilibrium between a system and an energy reservoir. Here, it is a particle energy reservoir. Suppose you have a large reservoir, that is A prime, and you have a small system, that is A. Between reservoir and system, there can be exchange of energy as well as exchange of particles. At equilibrium, the system and reservoir will have a common temperature T and a common chemical potential mu. But there can be variation for energy as well as number of particles. Okay, at equilibrium,
temperature of system and reservoir is fixed, chemical potential of system and reservoir is fixed, but energy and number of particles can vary for the system as well as reservoir. Suppose at any instant of time t, system A has a number of particles nr and energy es. At that time, the reservoir A prime has a number of particles nr prime and energy es prime. Since the system and reservoir combined together, they are like an isolated system. So the total number of particles of system and reservoir, the sum of nr and nr prime will be a constant. Also, es and es prime will be a constant. Energy and number of particles can vary between the system and reservoir. Okay, the combined system and reservoir is isolated from the surroundings. So we can write nr plus nr prime, the total number of particles. We can denote it as n0, which is a constant. Also, es plus es prime is equal to e0, that is also a constant.
Now, since the reservoir is supposed to be much larger than the system, the values of nr and es will be very small fractions of the total values n0 and e0. That is, we can write nr by n0 is equal to 1 minus nr prime by n0, which is very much less than 1. Also, es by e0 equal to 1 minus es prime by e0 is very much less than 1. Okay, we should keep this in mind. We will use this concept later. Now, we will calculate the probability. All these are the same procedure that we did in the case of canonical ensemble. Let PRS be the probability that at any instant of time t, the system A is found to be in any one of the microstate specified by number of particles nr and energy es. The interesting point is that this probability is same as the probability of finding the reservoir with an energy es prime and number of particles nr prime. Because when the system has energy es and number of particles nr, reservoir will have energy es prime and number of particles nr prime. We also know that the probability of finding a system in a particular macrostate is directly proportional to the number of microstates corresponding to that particular microstate. That is, the probability of finding the reservoir with an energy es prime and number of particles nr prime is directly proportional to the number of microstates corresponding to that particular energy es prime and number of particles nr prime. Therefore, our required answer, the probability of finding the system A in any one of the microstates specified by the energy es and number of particles nr, is directly proportional to, we can say it is omega prime. Okay, so we can write this nr prime as n0 minus nr and es prime as e0 minus es. So PRS is proportional to omega prime of n0 minus nr comma e0 minus es.
Now, since this nr and es are very small, we can do a Taylor expansion of omega prime around nr prime is equal to n0 and es prime is equal to e0. But we will do the Taylor expansion of log omega prime instead of omega prime. Why? Because this omega prime is a very large number.
If we take the logarithm, that will be a small number. So for convergence of the series, it will be better to expand log omega prime rather than omega prime. So we'll expand log omega prime as a Taylor series. Now it is a function of two variables, nr prime and es prime. So log omega prime of E0 N0 because our expansion is about E0 and N0. So the first term will be log omega prime E0 N0 plus dou by dou N prime of log omega prime into, here actually we have to write NR prime minus N0, and that is nothing but minus NR. This is minus NR. And the next term is plus dou by dou E prime of log omega prime evaluated at E prime is equal to E0 into, actually this should be ES prime minus E0, and that is nothing but minus ES plus second order terms. Okay, this is the general expression for the Taylor expansion of a single variable. F of x prime is equal to f of x plus, for a single variable no need to write this dou, you can write df by dx prime evaluated at x prime is equal to x into x prime minus x plus second order terms, etc. Okay, we can neglect the second order terms because this nr and es are very small. So second order terms will contain nr square, es square, etc. So that will be too small. So we can neglect that second order terms.
But as explained in lecture number 2, we have these identities dou by dou n of log omega is equal to minus mu by kt and dou by dou e of log omega as 1 by kt. Okay? These derivations we already did in lecture number 2. So you can please go through that lecture. So we can write here dou by dou n prime of log omega prime as minus mu prime by kt prime, and dou by dou e prime of log omega prime as 1 by kt prime. But the reservoir and system has the same chemical potential, that is mu prime is equal to mu, and same temperature, T prime is equal to T. Therefore, we can write log omega prime is equal to log omega prime of E0, N0 plus mu by kt into NR minus 1 by kt into ES. Okay, so I can write this omega prime proportional to, this term is a constant, you can take the exponential, omega prime proportional to e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES, where alpha is minus mu by kt and beta is 1 by kt. So you can write omega prime proportional to e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. Now, our probability of finding the system in energy ES and number of particles nr is PRS, that is proportional to omega prime, and omega prime is proportional to this quantity e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. That means PRS is proportional to e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. So I can write PRS equal to some constant A into e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. For finding this constant A, we can do normalization. That is, we can argue that the total probability should be 1. The system should be in any one of the microstate at a particular instant. Okay. So the probability, if you sum over various microstates, probability if you sum over various microstates, that should be 1. Okay, this summation should go through all the possible microstates of the system. Sigma PRS should be 1 because the system should be in any one of the microstate of the or in any one of the microstate specified by the microstate. So sigma PRS should be 1. So you apply this summation here, the left hand side becomes 1 and the right hand side becomes A into sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. That means A is equal to 1 divided by sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. Substitute back in this expression, we can write PRS equal to exponential minus alpha nr minus beta ES divided by sum over all the microstates e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. Summation goes over all the states accessible to a system A with energy S and number of particles nr. And interestingly, this probability is independent of the nature of the reservoir. This probability is independent of the nature of the reservoir. It contains only the parameters specified for the system.
Now, I would like to compare all the three ensembles once more. Microcanonical ensemble, canonical ensemble, and grand canonical ensemble. In the case of microcanonical ensemble, the macro state of the system is defined by total number of particles N, total volume V, and total energy E. That is, our system is an isolated system. Number of particles remains fixed, volume remains fixed, and total energy remains fixed. No exchange of energy or no exchange of particles. It is a completely isolated system. For that system, for this particular macro state, there will be a large number of microstates accessible to the system, and the probability of finding the system in any one of the microstates is given by P is equal to 1 by omega, where omega is the total number of microstates. All the microstates are equally probable for the system. So, probability of finding the system in any one of the microstate is given by 1 by omega. This is the case with microcanonical ensemble. Now, we will consider the canonical ensemble approach. The macrostate is defined by NVT, number of particles N, volume V, and temperature T. And here, exchange of energy is possible. So, we will consider the system in contact with a reservoir. Suppose it is an energy reservoir, then the system is specified by a number of particles N1, volume V1 and temperature T. Reservoir is specified by number of particles N2, volume V2 and temperature T. Here the temperature is fixed for both system and reservoir. There can be exchange of energy between the system and the reservoir. So the probability of finding the system in an energy eigenvalue ER is given by PR is equal to E raised to minus beta ER divided by sigma R E raised to minus beta ER. This is the case with canonical ensemble. For grand canonical ensemble, the macrostate is defined by mu, V and T, where mu is the chemical potential of the system, V is the volume and T is the temperature. Here, both exchange of energy and particles are allowed. So, we will consider a system in contact with an energy particle reservoir. The reservoir can exchange both energy and particle with the system. So, both the system and reservoir will have same chemical potential and same temperature, but volume is different. Here it is V1, this is V2. So, exchange of energy and particles are allowed. So, the probability of finding the system with an energy ES and number of particles NR is given by E raised to minus beta ES minus alpha NR divided by sum over all microstates E raised to minus beta ES minus alpha NR. This is the approach of the three ensembles for deriving the thermodynamics of the system. Now, we will move on to the second approach. For canonical ensemble also, we had two approaches. And the second approach is, consider our system as a member in the grand canonical ensemble. What is meant by grand canonical ensemble? It is a collection of identical systems like this. Suppose each of this square is a system. All this has the same chemical potential, same temperature. Okay, all these are specified by the same macrostate, that is mu, V and T are same for all these systems. But there are exchanges of particles and there is exchange of energy between these systems, member systems. Such a collection of systems is called a grand canonical ensemble. Suppose there are n identical systems and there is mutual sharing of the total number of particles n n bar and total energy n e bar. Where n bar is the average number of particles per system, e bar is the average energy per system in the ensemble. And suppose this small n r s, the number of system having number of particles nr and energy es. Okay, suppose this small nrs represent the number of systems having nr particles and es energy. Then we can write three conditions for grand canonical ensemble. The first one is total number of systems should be n. Okay, the number of systems having nr particles and es energy is given by n small n rs. If you sum over all the nr values and all the energy values es, then that should give you the total number of systems in the ensemble. That is the one first condition. Second one is summation over all nr values and all es values n rs multiplied with nr, that should give you the total number of particles, and that is nothing but n n bar. N bar is again the average number of particles in the in a system in the ensemble. And the other condition is sigma rs n rs es should be equal to n e bar, where e bar is the average energy per system in the ensemble. So these three conditions should be satisfied. If you recall the case with the canonical ensemble, there are only two conditions, restrictive conditions, the first one and the third one. Okay, because in that case there is no variation for number of particles among the member systems, and here there is a chance of exchange of particles among the member systems. So one more restrictive conditions will be there. So total there will be three restrictive conditions. Okay, now suppose this curly bracket nrs represents distribution set satisfies the restrictive conditions. Okay, these restrictive conditions can be satisfied by various distribution sets, and they can be denoted by this curly bracket nrs. Each of this distribution can be visualized in different ways. Let w of nrs denotes the number of ways in which each of this distribution can be visualized, then that number is given by w of nrs is equal to n factorial divided by pi rs nrs factorial. All these equations are exactly similar to the equation in the case of canonical ensemble. The only difference is here we have one more restrictive condition. Okay, so among this distributions, or for each distribution there are different ways in which we can visualize that distribution, and among the various distributions there will be a particular distribution for which the W value is maximum, or for that particular distribution the value of W is very high compared to all other distributions, and that particular distribution is known as most probable distribution. That is the one which maximizes this value of W. Okay, by satisfying the restrictive conditions given by these three. Now I will try to explain what is mean by this various distributions. Consider this simple case. Suppose there are four systems in the ensemble and there are three particles. Total energy is 3 epsilon. Okay, and I assumed that each particle can have either zero energy or epsilon energy. That is my assumption. With this, what are the possible states? The first possible state is a system with zero particles. Zero particle means energy can be zero or epsilon. Whatever it is, the total energy will be zero because there is no particles at all. The second state is the one with a single particle, and that is in the energy state zero. So total energy is zero. The next possible state is one particle, but that is in an energy epsilon. So total energy is epsilon for that state. The fourth one is two particles. One particle is at energy zero, other particle with energy epsilon. Then total energy will be epsilon. Fifth possibility is there are two particles, one with energy zero, the other one is also with energy zero. So total energy will be zero. Sixth possibility is two particles, one with energy epsilon, the second one with energy epsilon. So total energy is 2 epsilon. Seventh possibility is three particles, all the three has zero energy, so total energy is zero. Eighth possibility is three particles, two with energy zero, one with energy epsilon, so total energy is epsilon. Ninth possibility is three particles, one with energy zero, two with energy epsilon, total energy 2 epsilon. Tenth possibility is three particles, all the three with energy epsilon, and total energy is 3 epsilon. These are the 10 possibilities for this system. Then, what are the distributions? First distribution, I can write it as NRS1, and that is equal to three systems having the first state and one system having the 10th state. One system in the 10th state means all the three particles are in that system, and that system has an energy of 3 epsilon. The remaining three systems are in this first state, that is with zero particles and zero energy. Then total number of systems is 3 plus 1, 4. That is the first condition that is satisfied. The second condition is total number of particles among these four systems should be 3. Total number of particles is 3. And here we can see that in the first three systems there are 0 particles, and in the last system there are 3 particles. So that condition is also satisfied. Third condition is total energy of these ensembles should be 3 epsilon. For this first three systems, energy is 0. For the last system, energy is 3 epsilon. So total energy is 3 epsilon. All the three restrictive conditions are satisfied. Now consider another distribution, NRS2, that is two systems are in this first state, one system is in the third state, and one system is in the sixth state. Two systems are in the first state means there are no particles and total energy is zero. One system is in the third state means one particle is there and total energy is epsilon. And one system is in the sixth state means two particles are there and the energy is 2 epsilon. So among the four systems, total number of systems is 4. First condition is satisfied. Total number of particles in this two systems, 0 particles. In this system, 1 particle. And in this system, 2 particles. Total number of particles is 3. Total energy, these two systems have 0 energy. This system has an energy epsilon. This system has an energy 2 epsilon. So total is 3 epsilon. All the conditions are satisfied by this distribution set also. There is another distribution, NRS3, in which one system is in this state, state 1, and three systems are in this state, third state. Okay, three systems are in third state means one particle each. So total number of particles will be 3. That is satisfied. Total energy is 3 epsilon. That is satisfied. And the total number of systems in the ensemble is 3 plus 1, 4. That is also satisfied. So these are different distributions. And for these distributions, how many ways in which we can observe these distributions? That can be found by this equation. W is equal to n factorial divided by pi nrs factorial. So for this first distribution, it is given by 4 factorial. Total number is 4. 4 factorial divided by 3 factorial into 0 factorial into 0 factorial into 0 factorial into etc. and up to last one is 1 factorial. So you have to write here 0 factorial, 0 factorial, etc. You have to write all these 10 factorials in the denominator, but 0 factorial is 1. That's why I didn't write that. So this will give you a number 4. Okay, 24 divided by 6, it is 4. For the second distribution, it will be like 4 factorial divided by 2 factorial into 0 factorial into 1 factorial into 0 factorial into etc. That will give you 12. And the third distribution, that number is 4. And you can see that for this distribution, the number is 12, and that is very much high compared to other two. And this is a very simple example. When your number of systems is very large, or number of particles is very large, or energy is very large, then this distribution, there are a lot of possible distributions, and the number of ways in which a distribution can be visualized will be very large, and there will be a most probable distribution. For that, this number W will be very large compared to all other numbers. Now again, as in the case of canonical ensemble, we will calculate two quantities. One is n star rs divided by n, other one is expectation nrs divided by n, both in the limit of very large n. Okay, when the number of systems in the ensemble is very large, we will calculate these two quantities. Here n star rs is actually the number of systems corresponding to the most probable distribution. That is, this set of numbers are n star rs, and this expectation nrs or mean value of nrs is nothing but sum over all the distribution sets which are obeying the condition, restrictive condition 1, nrs w nrs. That gives the number of possible ways in which a particular distribution can be visualized, divided by sigma prime w of nrs. Here the primed summation means this considers only the distribution sets which are compatible with the restrictive conditions given by this equation 1. Okay, so we will calculate the most probable values and the expectation values, then divided by this n. The derivation of this n star by n is similar to the one we did in the case of canonical ensemble. The only difference is here the number of particles is also a variable. So using the Lagrange multiplier method, we can derive this equation. This alpha and beta are again Lagrange multipliers. Okay. Now you can calculate this nrs, mean value of nrs divided by n, and that is again e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es divided by sigma rs e raised to alpha nr minus beta es. Again, alpha and beta are some constants. And in these two cases, for expectation nrs by n and n star rs by n, this alpha and beta, we can show that they are similar to alpha equal to minus mu by kt and beta equal to 1 by kt using these relations. That is, average number of particle n bar is equal to sigma rs nr e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es divided by sum over all the microstates e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. This we can write it as minus dou by dou alpha of logarithm of sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. And the average energy e bar is again sigma es e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es divided by sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. This can be written as minus dou by dou beta of logarithm sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. Using these two expressions, we can show that these constants alpha and beta are respectively minus mu by kt and 1 by kt. Okay. And again, the proof is similar to the one we did in the case of canonical ensemble. So you can refer lecture number 7 and 8 for the derivations of these things. Okay. Now we will discuss the physical significance of various quantities. That is, how can we derive the thermodynamics of the system using the approach of grand canonical ensemble? So to establish a connection between statistics of the grand canonical ensemble and the thermodynamics of the system under study, we can define a quantity which is known as grand potential, and it is represented by small letter q, and it is defined as logarithm of sigma rs e raised to alpha nr minus alpha nr minus beta es. This summation runs over all the possible microstates of the system. Here q is defined as a function of alpha, beta and all the es values. So I can write q as a function of alpha, beta and all the es values. Therefore I can write the differential dq as dou q by dou alpha d alpha plus dou q by dou beta d beta plus dou q by dou es d es. Actually, this last term contains a lot of terms, which corresponds to dou q by dou e0 d e0 plus dou q by dou e1 d e1 and so on for all the es values. Okay, this is the total differential of q. Call this as equation number 2. Then dou q by dou alpha. What is dou q by dou alpha? You can say that dou q by dou alpha is, you have already the expression for q, take derivative with respect to alpha. Derivative of logarithm is 1 divided by x. So that becomes 1 divided by sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. Then function of a function. So you have to take the derivative of this summation sigma rs. Then e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. Derivative is exponential. E raised to x derivative is e raised to x itself. But the derivative is now with respect to alpha. So you have to take again function of a function rule. So, you have to multiply it with a minus nr, minus nr. And this is nothing but minus of, this is actually the mean value of nr. So, I can write it as minus n bar. Okay. Because mean value of any quantity is given by xp or xipi. This is mean value of a particular quantity x. Okay. So, here it is mean value of nr and the remaining is actually the probability. Okay, this thing is, we already proved that this is the probability. So, nr multiplied with the probability will give, sum over all states will give you average value. So, it is minus n bar. In a similar manner, you can take the derivative with respect to beta. Dou q by dou beta is again 1 divided by that quantity. Then summation e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. But now the derivative is with respect to beta. So, function of a function rule will give you a minus es to this side. And this is nothing but the average value of energy. So, it is minus e bar. Similarly, dou q by dou es. What is dou q by dou es? Again, the same procedure. 1 divided by sigma and sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. Now, the derivative is with respect to es. So, that will give you a minus beta here. So, that is minus beta. What is the remaining quantity? Remaining quantity is summation. And this quantity e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es divided by sigma. That quantity is nothing but this one. Okay. This quantity. So, I can denote it as expectation nrs divided by n. Expectation nrs divided by n. There is a summation here. So, we calculated all these three quantities, dou q by dou alpha, dou q by dou beta, dou q by dou es. Substitute back, you will get it as dq is equal to minus n bar d alpha minus e bar d beta minus beta by n into sigma n rs d es. Okay, this is the value of dq. Now, I can write it in a different form. Dq is equal to minus of this minus n bar d alpha, I will write it as d of n bar alpha minus alpha d n bar. Because d of n bar alpha, it will have two terms. One is n bar into d alpha. And the other one is alpha into d n bar. Alpha into d n bar will cancel with this term. So, you will get n bar into d alpha. That is exactly the quantity here. So, in a similar manner, I can write the second term as minus of d of e bar beta minus beta d e bar. Then that will result in e bar d beta. That is exactly the quantity here. And the last term I will write it as such, minus beta by n sigma expectation nrs into d es. Okay. Now, you can take this total differential d of n bar alpha and d of e bar beta to the left hand side. So, that becomes d of q plus n bar alpha plus e bar beta. This negative d of n bar alpha will go to the left hand side and that becomes positive. This negative d of e bar beta go to the left hand side and that becomes positive. So, total differential of sum of three quantities q plus n bar alpha plus e bar beta is equal to, from the remaining terms you take a beta outside, this negative and this negative becomes positive. So, this is alpha by beta dn bar, alpha by beta dn bar, and this negative and this negative becomes positive, beta you took outside, then it is dE bar, minus beta took outside, then 1 by n sigma expectation nrs into des. This is equation number 3. Now, from the first law of thermodynamics, we have a heat delta Q, change in heat of the system delta Q is dE bar, change in internal energy, plus delta W, work done, minus mu dN bar. Okay, this is associated with the, if there is a change in number of particles, then there will be this term. If there is no change in number of particles, we will have delta Q equal to dE bar plus delta W. Okay, this is equation number 4. Now, if you compare 3 and 4, we can see that if we take delta W as minus 1 by n sigma expectation nrs des and alpha by beta as minus mu, alpha by beta as minus mu, then we can say that this terms in the open bracket is exactly delta Q. We can write the terms inside this bracket as delta Q. If you identify, there is a dE bar and there is a dN bar. So, this coefficient alpha by beta, if you take it as minus mu and this quantity you take it as delta W, then the RHS becomes beta into delta Q, beta into delta Q. And beta being the integrating factor for delta Q, what is mean by integrating factor? This delta Q is not a perfect differential. Delta Q is not a heat exchanged between the system. It is not a path independent quantity. Okay, that is not a perfect differential. But beta delta Q is a perfect differential. Beta delta Q is given by d of a quantity. If you can write something as d of a quantity, then you can say that it is a perfect differential. So, beta into delta Q, this terms inside bracket is delta Q. Beta into delta Q is actually a perfect differential, but delta Q is not a perfect differential. So, beta is the thing which converts the imperfect differential to a perfect differential. That quantity is called integrating factor. And it must be equivalent to reciprocal of absolute temperature. For heat, the delta Q, the integrating factor should be equivalent to reciprocal of absolute temperature, because we know that ds is equal to 1 by T dq. Ds is a perfect differential, but dq is not a perfect differential. And the conversion factor from second law, we know that it is 1 by temperature. This T is absolute temperature. Now, I will explain actually what is the real meaning of integrating factor in mathematics. So, for that, I will take 2 slides. So, look at this. What is the meaning of a perfect differential? If f has a perfect differential, df, then I can write the integral a to b df as f evaluated at b minus f evaluated at a. If the quantity f has a perfect differential df, then it is possible to integrate that df from a to b. Then you will obtain it as f evaluated at b minus f evaluated at a. That is, the value of this integral depends only on value of function at n points. That is, we can say that if a quantity has a perfect differential and it changes from an initial value to a final value, then that change depends only on the initial and final states, not on the path through which the change occurs. Okay, that is the meaning of a quantity having a perfect differential. It will be a state function. Okay, state function means for that function, the change depends only on the initial and final states. Okay. Now, I'll give you an example. Let x be a function of y and z. Okay. Then I can write dx as something like, say, z cubed dy plus 2z plus yz square dz. X is a function of y and z means its differential dx, there will be only dy and dz terms. Okay. Since it is a function of y and z only, the right hand side will contain dy and dz. Now, the right hand side, we cannot write it as d of a particular quantity. D of a quantity which is a function of y and z. No way to write this right hand side like this. Now, in order to write the right hand side as a perfect differential, we can introduce an integrating factor. Integrating factor is something which, when multiplied with the imperfect differential, makes it a perfect differential. In this case, in this example, if you multiply the both sides with e raised to yz, then the right hand side becomes z cube e raised to yz dy plus 2z plus yz square into e raised to yz dz. This I can write it as d of z square e raised to yz. Now the right hand side is a perfect differential. We can write it as d of a particular quantity, which is a function of y and z. So we can say that e raised to yz is the integrating factor, and that factor converts the entire right hand side to a perfect differential. So that is the role performed by this 1 by t when making this dq, which is an imperfect differential, to ds, which is a perfect differential. That is called integrating factor. So here we can say that this entire thing in the bracket is delta q. So beta is something like an integrating factor, which makes the left hand side a perfect differential, d of a quantity. So I will write this as d of q plus alpha n bar plus beta e bar is equal to beta delta q. And we can write beta as inverse of temperature. We already mentioned that since it is an integrating factor. So I will write it as 1 by kt. Then alpha, we already wrote alpha by beta as minus mu. That means alpha becomes minus mu beta, and that becomes minus mu by kt. And this left hand side, q plus alpha n bar plus beta e bar, I can write it as s by k. Because if it is ds, then right hand side becomes 1 by t delta q. Now beta is 1 by kt, so the left hand side is, it should be s by k. So from this equation 6, we can identify beta as 1 by kt, alpha as minus mu by kt, and q plus alpha n bar plus beta e bar as s by k, where s is entropy of the system. So q, I can write it as s by k minus alpha n bar minus beta e bar. Or q, I can write it as multiply with a t. So ts plus mu n bar minus e bar divided by kt. But mu is chemical potential, n bar is average number of particles. So mu n bar is nothing but Gibbs free energy. So I can substitute for mu n bar as g. So that will become, and we also have another relation. Gibbs free energy g is internal energy e bar minus ts plus pv. So substitute that for mu n bar. This ts will cancel with this minus ts. E bar will cancel with this minus e bar. So remaining will be pv. So q is equal to pv by kt. So the grand potential q, which is defined as logarithm of sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es, is nothing but pv by kt. Call this as equation number 10. Now let us introduce another quantity, which is defined as fugacity, and it is denoted by the letter z. It is defined as e raised to minus alpha, where alpha is minus mu by kt. So fugacity z is e raised to mu by kt. We actually know that this entire thing is a function of mu. Q is a function of mu. But instead of keeping mu, we will define a new quantity z. So in terms of z, I can write q as logarithm of sigma Rs, sigma Rs, E raised to minus alpha becomes Z. So, this becomes Z raised to nr, Z raised to nr into E raised to minus beta Es. This summation is actually over all the nr values and over all the Es values. So, I will break the summation. Sigma nr equal to 0 to infinity E raised to minus alpha nr. And E raised to minus alpha is nothing but Z. So, that becomes sigma nr equal to 0 to infinity Z raised to nr. And remaining sigma Es equal to 0 to infinity E raised to minus beta Es. This is nothing but the partition function that we studied in the case of canonical ensemble. So, and this is for a particular nr value. So, I can write it as Q nr of Vt. This is partition function of canonical ensemble, because this summation is only over the all possible energy values. Variation of number of particles, we keep it here. So, grand potential Q is equal to logarithm of summation over nr Z raised to nr into partition function of canonical ensemble, with the definition that Q0 is equal to 1. What is the meaning of Q0? The partition function when the number of particles is 0. When there is no particles, that means energy will be 0 and the partition function will be 1. So, you define Q0 as 1. So, I can write Q as a function of Z, V and T. So, Q of Z, V, T is equal to logarithm of, I will write this entire quantity sigma nr Z raised to nr Q nr V, T as theta of Z, V, T, where theta of Z, V, T is sigma Z raised to nr Q nr of Vt is known as grand partition function. Grand partition function. And in terms of grand partition function, grand potential is just logarithm of theta. Grand potential or Q potential is logarithm of grand partition function. Now, we can see that to find theta, we have to calculate first Q. Okay. So, we have to calculate the partition function of canonical ensemble in order to evaluate theta from this equation. But in actual practice, on many problems, an explicit evaluation of Q is difficult, while the calculation of theta is very easy. Okay? Even though the equation seems like an calculation of Q is inevitable for the calculation of theta, we can see in many problems that even though the evaluation of Q is very difficult, we can easily calculate theta. That examples we will do later. And so, we can say that the formulation of grand canonical ensemble is very beneficial in that sense. We can, sometimes it may be difficult to calculate partition function for a canonical ensemble, but it is very easy to calculate theta in some problems that we will discuss later. So, now we will derive the entire thermodynamics from Q potential. We have Q is equal to log theta, and that is PV by KT. So, we can write P as KT by V, KT by V into log theta. Once we have the grand partition function theta, we can calculate pressure using equation 16. And the average number of particles n bar, we already given the equation, and it is minus dou by dou alpha logarithm of sigma e raised to minus alpha nr minus beta es. So, I can write it as n bar is equal to minus dou by dou alpha of q grand potential, but z is equal to e raised to minus alpha. That implies alpha is log 1 by z. So, I can change this dou by dou alpha into dou by dou z by writing it as dou by dou alpha equal to dou by dou z into dou z by dou alpha. Okay. What is dou z by dou alpha? From this equation, it is minus of e raised to minus alpha into dou by dou z. This dou by dou z. Dou z by dou alpha is minus e raised to minus alpha. So, I can write it as this e raised to minus alpha is again z. So, it is minus z dou by dou z. That is, dou by dou alpha, I can write it as minus z dou by dou z. Substitute here, you will get n bar, average number of particle as z dou by dou z, q of z vt, q of z vt. Also, we know that z is e raised to mu by kt. that is mu is equal to K T log Z. So again, dou by dou Z, I can convert it into dou by dou mu multiplied by dou mu by dou Z. But dou mu by dou Z is nothing but K T by Z. This Z, you can take it to the left hand side. So Z dou by dou Z is nothing but K T dou by dou mu. K T dou by dou mu. Therefore, average number of particle n bar, that is equal to K T into dou by dou mu of Q. Dou by dou mu of Q. When Q is expressed as a function of mu V T, I can write the average number of particle n bar. From here on, I will denote it as just n. This represent actually the average number of particles, because in grand canonical ensemble, number of particles is a variable. So you can define only an average number, and we will denote it as simply n. N, it's a function of mu V T, is given by K T dou by dou mu of grand potential. Now, what is average energy E bar? It is again this definition we already given. It is minus dou by dou beta of log sigma E raised to minus alpha nr minus beta ES. Again, this you can write it as minus dou by dou beta of grand potential Q. But beta is 1 by kT. So, T is 1 by k beta. I can write dou by dou beta as dou by dou T multiplied with dou T by dou beta. But dou T by dou beta is minus 1 by k beta square. So, I can write, substitute for dou by minus dou by dou beta as dou by dou t into minus 1 by k beta square is 1 by k square t square. So this becomes E bar is equal to average energy. I can denote it as U, that is equal to k t square. Okay, there is a negative sign here. There is a negative sign here. So that negative sign and this negative sign becomes positive. So, that becomes kT square into dou by dou T of Q. So, average energy is given by kT square into dou by dou T of grand potential. So, by now we have equation 16, which is equation for pressure. Equation 17, it is equation for average number of particles. Equation 18, it is equation for average energy. You can eliminate Z between 16 and 17 to obtain equation of state. But that we can done only after calculating Q for a particular problem. So, it will become clear when we deal with some examples in the next lecture. Again, by eliminating Z between equation 17 and 18, we can obtain U as a function of N, V and T. Now, we can calculate Helmholtz free energy, which is given by A is equal to G minus PV, where G is Gibbs free energy and it is nothing but mu into N, where N is actually the average number of particles, minus PV. But we have from the expression for fugacity, Z is equal to E raised to minus alpha and it is E raised to minus alpha is minus mu by KT. So, that becomes E raised to mu by KT. So, mu can be written as KT log Z. So, substitute for mu as kT log Z minus PV. From this expression, we can write PV as kT log theta. So, substitute here kT log theta. So, A is this. We can take a negative sign outside and write the second time first kT log theta minus kT into this N. You can take into the log. It becomes log Z raised to N. So, A you can write it as minus kT log theta divided by Z raised to N. If you recall the equation in canonical ensemble, Helmholtz free energy A was minus kT log Q. Here it is minus kT log theta divided by Z raised to N. Now, the most important property, it is entropy. Entropy S is given by U minus A by T. U, we already have an expression, kT square dot by dot T of Q. And A, we already have an expression minus kT log theta by Z raised to N. Substitute here and divided by T. The first time will be T square and T will cancel and you will get it as kT dou Q by dou T. And the second time this T and T will cancel, K log theta. Log theta is Q. So, that is KQ. There is one more term, K log 1 by Z raised to N. I can write it as minus NK log Z. So, entropy is given by kT dou Q by dou T minus NK log Z plus KQ. Okay. Now, we will discuss the examples in the next class. For different systems, we will calculate all these thermodynamic quantities. by using the formulation of grand canonical ensemble. Okay, thank you.